This is Political Radar Pulse with Rhonda Sitnikau, where we explore the issues facing Northeast Wisconsin and beyond with insightful interviews and open discussions.
Hey, all you political junkies. Welcome to Political Radar Pulse, the best 30 minutes of unscripted and uncensored political talk you will hear all day. In the studio with me for episode number 2 is Brian Johnson, who is the On Broadway Incorporated Executive Director. Welcome to the show.
Thanks. I'm happy to be here. Excited to talk about some cool things we got coming up.
So other than the Farmers Market, which is an amazing event and experience in the Broadway District, tell us what On Broadway does.
So it's an economic development organization for the Broadway District. And a big part of what we do is we're trying to deliver value back to the property owners in the district who are part of our business improvement district. We want to see our businesses succeed in the district, and we're trying to create a space that people feel safe, people feel welcome, they find the amenities and entertainment options that they're looking for. So ultimately, it's creating a district that's just vibrant, full of life and activity that keeps people coming back.
And so you've been with On Broadway as the executive director since May?
Since May, about 10 months now.
Okay, and is there anything about the working, within the district that you believe has opened your eyes up to, something that maybe you thought that was happening that, now you're really excited about it? Or is there anything out there that you are, that has really made you love this job?
Oh, there's so much. It's, when you come into a new position, you always have this impression of what you think it's going to be. And then inevitably you find out it's the exact opposite. And certainly I came into this position excited about all of the opportunities and I knew there were some challenges and that certainly hasn't disappointed. But it's also one of those things that I thrive on and I'm excited to take on. And so when you start to take a look at the opportunities that the district presents itself, it's really one of those districts I think that's underdeveloped, maybe underperforming in certain areas. But there's a strong foundation in place that's going to really help us catapult this into the next level.
Okay, so let's get right to it. There's a lot happening in regards to On Broadway and the city of Green Bay. And one of the topics of that's hot topics out right there right now is a proposal, a $13.5 million entertainment district proposal that's actually at the south end of Broadway, which is called the Shipyard.
Mm-hmm.
And I know it's Big Top Baseball as a big player in this, and that's not a pun, Randy Scannell. They're coming into this. They're the owner of the Bullfrogs. They want to, basically revitalize and create a portion of the district that just really nothing's happening there. And this is something that includes a baseball venue, concert venue, and then there's some other businesses that are interested in being part of that. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, I mean, the Shipyard development is just one of those things that we really think is going to be a catalyst for that southern end of the district. And not only for the commercial space that exists down there, but for the residential as well. As part of this development, you'd mentioned some of the other commercial projects that are part of it. But what's not often talked about is some of the neighborhood redevelopment that comes along with that as well. And so you have some neighborhood funds, upwards of $1 million, that's expected to be invested into this as well. And so you've got properties that are undervalued over there compared to the balance of the city. And so part of that neighborhood enhancement is to bring those up to more appropriate levels, not only from an assessment perspective, but obviously to bring value back to our property owners. So that's a big part of it. The outdoor event center, the baseball field being a component of it, is clearly the catalyst project that's the momentum for everything else.
And they said that's going to be an operation 150 days out of the year, correct?
Correct. And so, and that's the part where the city gets involved, of course. And so it would be a city-owned amenity. Big Top Baseball, the organization, they're really an event management organization, would lease it from the city. And so they've been talking.
But the city's going to own this.
It is. It's a city-owned property. And so and Big Top Baseball would lease it. It would be a 20-year lease. And they would have not only the Bullfrogs there, they've got a proposal on the table, offer accepted to bring in a semi-pro soccer team. And they have agreements with Green Bay West High School to host a number of their events there, outdoor concerts, and some other things that they'd like to bring in as well.
Okay, and along with that, it's been reported that Anduzzi's is interested in putting $2 million towards a project, as well as Mark Scogan from Festival Foods. He's looking into putting in $2.5 million into the concert venue as well. So there are stakeholders coming into this other than just the city of Green Bay.
Yeah, and as you can imagine, I don't think it should come as any surprise. I mean, Anduzzi's and the indoor concert venue being proposed by Mark Scogan are really contingent on the outdoor event center being built. Certainly, they could go ahead and do those things on their own, and they may. But I think it's, you know, speculation to think that, I mean, the Outdoor Event Center is really the key piece of this.
Okay, so this was actually before the city last year. And so they, you know, they went through the process in committee and had discussions and, you know, never really got too far. They were asked to tighten it up a little bit. I also think they were, you know, asked to bring out maybe who some of the potential interests were. And now that they're out there and it's public, maybe that, you know, there's more of a chance this will get, you know, a better, I don't know, people out there will be a little more supportive of it. But there was, you know, the price tag is a lot. It's $8 million is the price tag. So what do you say and how can you silence the critics about the financial piece of this? Like, what are your thoughts on that?
I mean, you're looking actually at a $9 million proposal right now. Initially, Big Top Baseball had been proposing to put $1 million up front. I believe there's some slight modifications maybe to that development agreement that will be brought out that'll be favorable both for the city and for Big Top Baseball. But essentially what you're going to see is at the end of this project, Big Top Baseball will have financed about half through their lease payments of what it's going to take to build this project. And so after a 20-year lease, you're going to see a community amenity that will be paid for half by private industry. And so when you look at things like the City Deck, beautiful project that served as a catalyst, obviously, for that entire side of the river, we need something similar on this side of the river and on the southern end of that district in particular. You have a piece of land here that sat vacant for, what, 30, 40 years? This is the most tangible project that's been brought forth to the city in that time frame.
And is that a greenfield?
No, I believe there is some brownfield. I believe it's brownfield, labeled as a brownfield yet.
Okay.
But the things that are there aren't that significant.
Okay.
So I mean, this is the most tangible project that's been brought forth in that time period. And so I would just really hate to obviously see that site sit again and under city control for another 30, 40 years before a different project brought forward.
And this is actually not on the table right now. They're, like I said, they're tightening up their proposal and they're getting things ready to bring to committee to the city of Green Bay because, you know, obviously you're interested in this and helping lift the district up, but, you know, you are at the mercy of the city council.
Absolutely, yeah.
Right. So that is one thing that I think sometimes people forget about is that the Broadway district and the development and on Broadway, you know, really do rely on, especially for development and zoning changes and whatnot, the city council has to come into play. So right now, I know, was it 2 or 3 weeks ago, the stadium board was approached at possibly being a stakeholder in this and a, you know, a player in this. Mm-hmm. And what was the result of that?
The stadium board has expressed a lot of interest in doing something with it. They just needed another month to review documents. So Big Top Baseball and the city of Green Bay will be in front of the stadium board again next month with the same proposal. And there was very, very warm interest, hot interest, I would even say, with the members of the stadium board. They just needed time to review documents.
Are you looking at trying to get this off the ground and maybe shovels in the ground by summer?
Yeah, so the last update that I'd received early this morning was they'd like to probably see this on the June council meeting, which of course means that it would have to, the development agreement would have to get approved by the redevelopment authority prior to that. But I think there's every indication that this will get done. Get done in the sense that the agreement will be ready to be presented by then. And there's another project I believe that might be tied to this. More to come on that yet, but it's, the critics on this project, I mean, this is a catalyst project for other development that's going to add to the taxable base. So the stadium itself would not be on the tax roll because it would be city owned. But when you start talking about some of these other developments that, you know, may or may not, probably not happen, if the stadium doesn't happen, those are all projects that will add significant value to the tax roll.
Well, right. You'll have assessed value and you'll have tax revenue that you don't have right now.
Right. And you have a plan really to develop the neighborhoods around that area as well.
And is this in line with that plan? So right. There are people out there right now, you know, there's a few other proposals that are happening in the city. And some of the critics are saying, well, this, you know, where's the plan? Is this something that was, you know, part of a plan? Is this the, you know, the best and, wisest choice and usage for this piece of land? And I can't imagine what else you'd put on there.
Well, I mean, we've had 30, 40 years
right.
to come up with plans and nothing of any material substance has come up. And here you have what I think is just a marvelous plan. I mean, to really build up that southern end of the district. You've got other projects that are coming with it. This is a great deal for the city, and I think it would be a sad shame to see them pass on it. I don't think they will, but obviously the devil's in the details. There's a lot of number crunching to do.
Well, and if the stadium board comes on and, contributes, I'm sure that will make a big difference.
Absolutely.
As well. So that what we're looking at, the proposal we're looking at from the last time that came forward could be quite different.
It likely will be. I mean, there are going to be some changes in the lease structure. You could have, like I said, you've got differences in the projects that are coming or piggybacking on top of this. And if the stadium board does decide to invest in it, these are all things that change the terms.
And can we just, if there's people that are listening or watching out there that aren't really aware of where this is in relation to the Broadway District, you're probably better at this, a better idea of where it's at, located at.
Yeah, it's near the boat slip on the southern end of Broadway, right where Mason overpasses Broadway.
Okay, right underneath.
Right on the riverfront. Yep.
Okay, and is there any, I know this has been brought up, any environmental type of concern with HVAC systems or anything in there if you have, because of the ships and everything coming through, the coal dust, is there anything, because that was a question that was sent.
Yeah, and
about this.
I believe that's part of the due diligence that's being conducted. I mean, when the proposal comes forward, there's going to be a lot of things that come along with it. I know that's been part of the discussion, is how do you minimize some of that, along with a comprehensive parking plan is another one of the concerns in the rail crossings. And those are all things that are going to be addressed in the development plan. This plan will not move forward until those things are addressed.
Because I think that was one of the, the deal breakers last time. They didn't really have a lot, because I did follow it pretty closely. Mm-hmm. They didn't have a lot to share in regards to those issues at all. But now they plan to.
Yeah, and like I said, when you start looking at some of those concerns that have been raised throughout the process, every major project comes with concerns, and that's okay, and you should if you're really doing your diligence. And so it's just how you react and respond to those. And the owners from Big Top Baseball have just been tremendous to work with, and they've been very responsive to the community and to the constituents in our district, and so we've been really excited to work with them.
Well, even calling it the shipyard and labeling it mm-hmm. something and, branding it as something, I think that was a smart move as well.
Yeah, you bet. It's a comprehensive plan, again, that brings in not only the commercial but the residential side.
Okay, so speaking of comprehensive, because you had sent me some other things that On Broadway is working on, the comprehensive streetscape design.
Mm-hmm.
What's happening with that?
Yeah, so we were afforded a grant from the state of Wisconsin, the Wisconsin Economic Development Corporation, for a tech visit. We have an expert that'll come in here at the beginning of April. They're going to start the process. We'll likely have some work to do to finish it off, but really to take a look at the streetscape design within the Broadway District. Right now, there's a lot of cool things that go on, a lot of quirky things, whether it's the painted benches, the banners, things of that nature, but there's not really a lot of cohesion to what we're doing and how these things intersect with one another. And so we're bringing in an expert to help us create a streetscape design that gives us a brand, it gives us a feel that ties in everything from wayfinding signage, which really doesn't currently exist, to, again, how all of those things, the banners, the just the planters, and how everything ties together. We don't want it to look like a rummage sale out there.
Are they going to feng shui the Broadway District? Is that what you're saying?
Are they going to what?
Feng shui it.
I don't know that word.
You
can't just make up words, Rhonda.
Feng shui, that's a word. Okay, so green space. I have to mm-hmm. ask, where the hell is this green space? I want more green space. Can you
Light's
bring
Park.
More green space?
Light's Park. So Light's Park is one of those, I think, is really one of those underutilized treasures in our district.
And yeah, it is, because I don't even think about it.
Right. And on a daily basis, we are having conversations about how do we better activate that space for the community, to really find value and to utilize that. And that could be by way of events. It could be just the implementation of different things that people can use it for on a daily basis. We've talked about even development that could perhaps go on the perimeter, which, of course, flows over into the Larson Green development, which has now been rebranded as the Rail Yard. And so that's another area where there could be the incorporation of some green space.
Aren't they going to tie the two together? Is that some sort of a walkway? Isn't that what the plan is, to have a walkway between Light Park and Larson Green?
It's possible.
I feel like I saw that somewhere.
Yeah, I can't recall having seen that, but we'll go with that, yes.
Okay, I think back in the no Walmart days, I think they talked about that. Okay, so, that's right. Don't say that word. I will. We don't need to go there. Okay, the Broadway Beat, you're going to resurrect that. What is that?
Well, it's just a newsletter. We've already done that. It's out there. We'd love people to come subscribe. We just need to do a better job as an organization of communicating to the community and to our stakeholders what we're doing.
And if I'm going to read that, what's going to be on it?
So we partner up with Downtown Green Bay and What's Up Downtown, and so we like to rely on that newsletter for our business to be able to share different things that they've got going on. We instead take a different focus on our newsletter so that it's not redundant. Really focusing maybe in profiles of our businesses and things that are going on in the district that we want people to know about.
And you said that's out there right now?
It is.
And how could someone subscribe?
Just shoot me an email, brian@onbroadway.org.
And then they would
and
get
we'll
that.
We'll get you added.
Okay. And then, okay, I noticed this as well, and I took part in it, the farmer's market survey that is out there right now. So are there big changes coming with that, or what's going on?
Well, we have a new marketing and events manager, Chelsea McGuire, and she's been absolutely fantastic to work with, and we're, it's really putting her into a position to be successful. And so she's coming into this position obviously new, and she needs to hear some feedback. And whether that's from vendors or business owners, just general community members, we need to know what we're doing well. This is part of a continual assessment process to make sure that we continue to do the things that we're doing well, but we're really taking a step back and assessing those things where we're maybe underperforming and how do we improve those areas.
I love that you're just trying new things with it.
Oh my God, yeah, that we've got so many cool ideas that we're ready to implement this year. We really want to, we do get some feedback that it's maybe grown into too much of a festival. But one of the things I think that we contend is that the Saturday farmers market performs really well. Ours perform really well. And they're two very distinctly different experiences. And we're okay with that. And we're going to continue to own that. And I truly believe that if they were identical markets, neither of them would be as successful as they are. And so we're going to continue to maintain the farmers market approach, but we're not shy about saying that we're going to continue to incorporate some of the other things that make it a curated experience that people enjoy and they want to come out and spend their Wednesday.
Well, and the numbers tell you that people are enjoying it because there's always a lot of people there.
Absolutely. But we still want our farmers and obviously our other vendors to be successful at the market. And so we're not trying to create a party, if you want to call it that. But I wouldn't shy away from calling it a festival.
Well, sometimes they just, they just happen to happen, though. I mean, it's a great experience.
Right. And we still want to maintain it, obviously, as a community event. And so it's going to continue to be a family-friendly event. And one of the things that we're trying to bring in is more of the interactive art demonstrations. And art could be fine art. It could be performing art. It could be culinary art. But there's definitely some things that we want to incorporate into the series.
What about the night market? What's that all about?
Oh, this is exciting. So it's modeled after a night market that occurs in Milwaukee, but it focuses on artisans and makers. It'll occur 4 separate days, June through September. We're partnering with downtown Green Bay and Old Main Street. So it really shows that the collaboration that maybe previously hasn't occurred with our downtown organizations, we're definitely headed in that direction. And so it's a market that, again, that's focused on artisans and makers and really about interactive art. And so how do we, people might walk through and maybe see live blacksmiths or hip-hop ballet or maybe a human-sized checkerboard. We've talked about projection mapping on buildings and original live music. So everything is about curating original experiences, creative experiences. We want people to connect with different spaces in our districts. So it will rotate. And it's not going to be the traditional spaces. We will have one in Light Park. We're excited about that. We're going to do a hot air balloon glow that evening as well, which will be neat. But that one will also have a national touring act, whose name I cannot release yet. I've got to keep you a little bit in suspense.
So much teasing in one episode.
But that's going to be a really unique experience in the city of Green Bay that maybe people just haven't seen the likes of before here.
So is that actually just an isolated, like one night, or is this going to be an ongoing weekly thing?
No, it's once a month.
Once a month, okay.
Yep. So it'll be a series. We'll do 4 of them next year, and then we'll assess. We'll see how it goes.
Okay, and do you have the day of the week picked out for that?
It'll be a Saturday night.
Oh, God, cool.
Yeah. So think of it as like a carnival. I mean, okay. It's really, we want this to just be absolutely weird and allow people to come out and enjoy themselves.
Okay, and where are you going to be? I mean, there's a lot you have going on. Where do people look for this? Is it like just social media? Are you going to do some press releases? Are we going to look at, a big media push on this?
Oh, yeah, this will be huge. We've got Fox Communities Credit Union on already as our title sponsor, and so they're going to be great partners, and we're procuring other sponsors for the event right now. Working on media partners, we've got several of those locked up as well. I would expect public announcement coming on that very soon.
Okay, and I know one of the alders, Alderman Stoyer, had they've been trying to work on something for a while, a type of very similar to the Mile of Music Festival that Appleton has. And I noted that that was something that you were working on. Are you working with Strike Accord, or are there other organizations you're working for? Is this what is that what?
Yeah, we've had some preliminary discussions with one of the founders of Mile of Music, Corey Schizel, and and we've been working or having conversations with him and his team about trying to do something in the downtown area. And so this is another opportunity where we would collaborate with downtown Green Bay and Old Main and allow our different venues to become part of an experience that's distinctly different. We want to bring in the focus on the original live music again, but there are some other components that we'd like to incorporate that would make it a little bit more of an untraditional event.
And that's a very successful event in Appleton.
Oh, in such a short amount of time as right. well. And so when we look at that, we know that that's something that'll benefit our businesses greatly. So we're excited to partner with them.
And then urban golf, what is that?
Yeah, these are just some of the fun, crazy events that we've been trying to introduce. But think of it as golf, but use tennis balls. Little damage control there.
And where are you doing this at?
No, we just do it through the district. Have
oh my
some
God.
Fun. Very casual events that just bring people down to the district to experience it in a way that is a little bit weird and different. And so I think there's this traditional mindset of the experience that people are supposed to have when they come down Broadway. Mm-hmm. We're trying to shake that up a little bit because not everybody connects to the district in that traditional way. And right. so by curating different types of events that attract different crowds or audiences, we know that we're going to reach a much broader audience.
And Chalk Fest, is that one of those?
Yeah, Chalk Fest is another one that we're talking about. That'll happen actually at the end of April. It's very similar to our Winter Wine Walk, but we're going to do brews. The Broadway Beer Hop.
Okay.
A little fun play on words there. So that'll be just another way for people to get into our stores to see them. One of the things that we hear from the Winter Wine Walk often, we have about 25 stores that participate. Mm-hmm. People walk in, they get their samples of wine, they experience some of our local wines that we have in the region. And so many times people are like, I've never been in a store. I didn't know it existed. And so it's really about opportunities to expose people to what we have to
Alcohol offer. Brings everyone together.
So does chocolate.
That's true. Okay. And so in regards to, all the events happening and whatnot, is there anything else, as far as like the Winterfest? I know that was something that there were people that were disappointed that it went away. Is there anything in relation to just winter that's coming back?
Yeah, we have to be more of a year-round event organization. And while our focus isn't exclusively on events are one of those things that bring the community together. And so we do have our lighting ceremony in November. The Winter Wine Walk in December, but January through May is kind of a dead time for us. And so we're trying to introduce some new event concepts. We've had discussions, and again, I'm not committing to us doing these, but we've had discussions of reintroducing Winterfest. We've talked about creating a Christmas market. So these are all different things that are successful in other communities and have been successful here in the past. So how do we maybe just tweak them a little bit? To ensure that they meet the needs of the district right now. Our goal is to bring people down here. We know that when people come down here, they love it, and they love the experience and the enchantment that the district offers. And so we just need to find more ways to do that.
Is there anything else that you want to talk about in regards to events at all?
We're open. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, it's open season. If people have ideas, we want to hear them.
And if you're a person, I've had a few people reach out to me and they talked about how do you even get into to having a business, to being a business owner in the district? Is there some sort of, protocol they have to follow? I mean, there's someone they need to talk to other than you? Are you the person?
Well, I mean, certainly I can be the starting point. Sometimes we've talked to people that certainly have a very specific business in mind and they need a certain type of space. Other times people just want to be a part of the culture that we're creating down here. And it is right now a very unique boutique niche, if you will, that we've created. But there are a lot of other opportunities as well, including commercial space, office space. Obviously, the breweries and the restaurants and different things of that nature have really lent itself to almost this third ward type of experience.
Well, you
district.
Said the rail yard. So that's the piece of Larson Green that's now being, basically they're revamping that entire old cold storage building, which I think is amazing. Those buildings are amazing. So there's going to be office space available there. Is it going to be a live-work situation? What's happening there?
Well, I think that's undetermined yet. The building that they're currently, that DDL Holdings has under contract is almost full. There are a couple of unique spaces within that building. They're negotiating with the city to come to terms on the acquisition of the balance of that property. And so that would be the other two storage buildings from Larson Green, including all of the land that's there. So there's townhomes being talked about, some other types of housing, including standalone commercial projects. And of course, how do we renovate those other two buildings and what's going to be a part of those? And we've got a great team that's leading that effort and we're just happy to be in a supporting
role. And there might be green space there.
It's a very high probability.
I know I keep saying that, but is there anything else you want to add to our conversation at all?
Well, what? How much time do we have?
We don't have much time. It goes really fast. We have like three-ish minutes.
Yeah, I mean, it's just certainly one of the things we're looking at doing is rebuilding our team as well. And so from a staffing perspective, we're in a great position, and we may look to add another position about halfway through the year, but a volunteer base. It's really critical for us to be successful that we have people engaged and committed and passionate about what we're doing. And I think we've got all the right pieces in place now. And so now we're just we're always looking for great bodies, people that want to either just volunteer on a one-off basis, people that want to serve on our committees. There's a lot of great ways for people to get involved, and it's an opportunity really to transform the community.
So if somebody wanted to serve on a committee, what would they need to do?
Just email me.
Okay.
We'll get them plugged into the right thing.
Okay.
And then think about living down here, too. We have a great residential campaign, Love Here, Live Here.
Well, there's other places. Now there's, what is, I'm trying to think of the apartments that are, were just built not that long ago in the corner of Dousman and Broadway. I'm spacing
Flatton
the name.
Place.
Flatton Place.
Yep, those are all full.
They
I
are.
Think there may be one or two vacancies.
Okay, well, that's good.
Yep, but we have 20 new one-bedroom apartments that are going to be opening up as well, right across from the Larson Green site.
Okay.
So there are some housing. There's a lot of housing options down here. And then when you look at the Love Here, Live Here campaign, that's specifically targeting homeowner-occupied homes within the district. You're a block away from owning your own home in a downtown district, and that's really unique about what we
have. And the city's working on some programs in regards to that as well.
Yeah, they are. We've been working very closely with them, and they've acquired one property as a catalyst project, and you'll see some others come online as well that are going to really help kind of transform some of those neighborhoods.
Yeah, great. It's all good, feel-good stuff, so... how can someone get in touch with you? I know you mentioned your email. Can you give us any other contact information?
Yeah.
Maybe just repeat it again.
Yeah. Brian Johnson, look me up on LinkedIn, Facebook. I love connecting with people there. But email Brian, B-R-I-A-N, at onbroadway.org.
Well, that wraps up episode number 2 of Political Radar Pulse. For show notes, go to politicalradarpulse.com/2. And if you're watching this episode on YouTube, do not forget to like, subscribe, and hit the bell to get notifications. If you would like to support the show, you can share this episode on Facebook and Twitter, and you can buy shirts or other merchandise at politicalradar.com/shop. Thanks.
Thank you for watching Political Radar Pulse. To ensure that you'll never miss an episode, subscribe on YouTube or your favorite podcast app. To check out more episodes of Political Radar Pulse, visit politicalradarpulse.com or connect with us on Facebook or Twitter.